inside you can transfer in the femoral artery, and then in 80s some cardiac catheterization was performed by God Bernard in the course. And later on, because the Sons, 1959, which performed first elective coronary arteriography, and then it was modified by Ricketts and Abrams, and later on Lutkins. And 1977, the Andreas Grusin, it introduced the concept of balloonoplasty. Now, conventional angiography is basically a humanography. Insert the diet of the coronary artery and radiographic diet and see the human filled by the diet, which we see in the fluoroscopy. And different views we take for that. Now, there are some procedure-related complications or maybe limitations. Now, some posterior left main stenosis, based on the catheter routine, and if there is some posterior stenosis in the catheter inside, then we can have false assessment of posterior. We miss the posterior stenosis. False negative posterior lesion. If the catheter passes the posterior lesion and we instantly die, then osteo is not seen through osteo. So in some cases, we may miss the through osteo lesion. And it's necessary osteo left main cases. Now, superimposition of branches is also a common problem. The calorie diagonal, obtuse margin, RC and RV branch. And angulation is needed for correct projection of the arteries. Force shortening is another issue. Viewing of vessel in a plane with its long axis cannot displace entire length, and then sophistication of segment seen on end on end produce some appearance of a lesion in intervening segment. The solution is artery seen from coming towards or away from the imaging square should be viewed in angulated views. Now, inadequate vessel sophistication by the dye streaming with the blood, which negatively impacts the viewing quality. Some cases like LV hypertrophy, AR or anemia, like high flow situations, there is a rapid movement in flow in the coronary circulation. So if we insert the dye, facility the dye is capacity is insufficient to completely opacify the vessel. So some filling defects sometimes may present. Sometimes diagnostic catheter positioning is not coaxial with the coronary ostium. So most of the dye goes in the aorta instead of the coronary artery. And sometimes small four fence catheters also is unable to occupy the vessels. And during forceful injection of dye, the catheter comes out, which can also cause coronary. It happens many times. We have to take the issue. Now, we say ring is depressed with the degree of the ostial and side fence disease. And usually, the thrombus and stenosis severity is overestimated. Solution is forceful injection of contrast agent and switching to angioplastic guiding catheter, which has a larger lumen and softer tip. Now, most common problem is inter-observer variability. The same angiography shown to the 10 cardiologists, 10 different occurrences will be there. So, solution is QCA. Quantitative coronary analysis. It is a machine generated software. It is present in most cath labs, and we can give rough estimate of the stenosis and the length of the disease. The coronary spasm is also much common. Usually, it is much more common in RCA. It's falsely sources to the others. If we give microcoronary, retrocoronary, nitroglycerin, the spasm goes away. And wire induced accordion effect only if it avoids wire is tortuous and we insert into wire the vessel status. So the false stenosis becomes. So it also happens many times. Now eccentric lesions are common. In some view the lesion is circular by both angulations is here tight stenosis. But if the stenosis is eccentric. So in one view, it will not be severe, but in another view, it will be acting severe. So that's why multiple views are required in angiography. In some eccentric lesions, in one view, it may not be severe, but in another view, eccentric lesions may become severe. And in such cases, ulcerated plaque also, the stenosis is not severe, but due to the ruptured plaque and acute coronary syndrome, these patients have to be treated. The plaque composition is also more important. In angiography, we can't see the plaque composition, how is the plaque, plaque is outside the vessel or in negative remodeling. Vulnerable plaque is a large lipid wall with thick fibrous cap. And thick fibrous cap is less at risk for rupture. And coronary remodeling is more important. If the plaque grows inside the vessel, often in the lumen, it is more dangerous. And but if the plaque burden is severe, but it goes outside the lumen, towards the abdominal wall, and also plaque burden is high, but it coronary angiography is not visible. And functional correlation. There is no functional measurement in routine angiography. For intermediate is 40 to 70%. So basically borderline lesions of may say it is severe, some may say it can be left alone. But objective evidence has to be done. Now lesion assessment, there are various methods. Routine coronary angiography, there is either a high volume by different cardiologists or quantitative analysis. And another physiological test like FFR and anatomical imaging testing like IOS and OCT are much helpful. Now, any stenosis more than 70% of diameter of the vessel is considered severe and it causes pressure drop across the lesion, whereas borderline lesions are 40 to 70%. Visual assessment usually less than 50% are underestimated, more than 50% are overestimated. Advantage is easy and quick for routine angiography, but the second is there are lots of errors. Now, systemic assessment of each blockage is important, which we call syntax score. Multiple lesion characteristics which you have to define in angiography, and ideally you have to write in the angiography report. So that if the any report is shown to other cardiologists or any other person, it may be very helpful. Like the first is the lesion severity percentage wise, then the classification is present or not, presence of ulcerated thrombus, the boundaries of the lumenogram, sometimes it's ulcerated or irregular, which we can see in the angiogram. Degree of tortuosity, length of the lesion, reference vessel size. Distal vessel is adaptable or not in case of TVD, if advisable for CAVD, how many grafts surgeons should put, where to put, that should be ideally written in the angiography report. Any bifurcation, lesion, trifurcation, and which classification, medical classification we have to write. Kidney myocardial prostate in MI situation, we have to write. And if there are any presence of collaterals in case of CAVD, that also we have to mention. There is a reduce of collaterals and post classification, there also we have to mention it.
Who decides this syntax?
Syntax score is basically a format.
Who decides?
Yeah, either we
have. Human being. Can the software
enter each lesion?
Can software can do this? Because there are multiple variables.
In these trials, major trials where syntax score is calculated, there is isolated third party, which doesn't get involved. They only see for software angiography, and they see the angiography and they calculate the syntax score. They are expert in that. So third party they do syntax.
Again human comes. Again human comes.
Yes. If you miss one lesion, if we know the miss one lesion, then syntax score is also.
Because it is a multiple variable things.
Variable. The lesion length is also more important. More than 20 mm is diffuse. The diabetic patients have common diffuse varices. And in such patients, instant response rates are higher. Now, lesion length can be measured by multiple parameters, and distance from normal to normal segment also there. Anyway, many times in diabetes there are diffuse lesions, but the most critical part is some part of that one. Otherwise, there are diffuse plaque. Tandem lesions are also found multiple times. Like two or three tandem lesions in between there is a normal segment. For this also, this USA is long, maximum length is 38 mm, which is FPA. Whereas in India and other states, 48 mm lines and even 60 mm tanks are also available. But in US, it is not FPA approved. Because there is no restriction of tank. You can basically all these are short. So they put long lesions, they put 2 or 3 tanks. Whereas here, we have to cost tanks. We have to put longer tanks to shorten the number of tanks. Osteal lesions, any lesion within 3 mm origin of the vessel is called osteal. Either biota osteal or non-biota osteal. And usually they are fibrotensive in RCA and LMCA. splenectomy is usually required. And by positioning less than 1 mm stem should be in aorta. And also true ostium, even 1 mm ostium is missed during stenting, then also rates of ISR increase drastically. So precise ostial placement of stent is very important. Now you see that at a 2D or 3D calculation, two orthogonal views are required. And the 3D imaging also utilizes 2D imaging in reconstructions. Yeah. So this is a sample of UCA. In our case, I'm also expecting. We have to first mark the markers and then the lesion with stenosis and automatically will be calculated. And 3D reconstruction can also be done. This is the basically characteristics of the lesion. In our angioplasty, we usually divide in ABC three different lesions. A is the most simple ones, B is some complex, and C is most complex, like CTOs, calcified, tortuous lesions. These are the various parameters of the lesion characteristics which we use for the lesion. TV flow rates are important, basically the velocity of the flow in the vessel. In MI situation, usually the mean toward T flow are usually better. And this is the most important in post-stenting scenario. In post-plasty, if the TV flow 3 is there, it means that the good reverse pressure is better. And in TV 2 or 1 flow post-stenting, it suggests there is poor prognosis and the poor bilateral reverse pressure. TV 0 flow is no anti-grid flow. TV 1 flow is penetration only without perfusion, pain anti-grid flow. TV 2 is partial repulsion. TV 3 is full repulsion. The myocardial blush perfusion grades are also there. It shows the it suggests a micro circulation characteristic. If there is a good myocardial perfusion grade perfusion plus, it suggests that the good micro circulation is intact and it is FFIR is also we have is nowadays it is routinely used at many centers. This is an absolute, basically FFI is a pressure difference between proximal to distal stenosis and coronary, which is based on the coronary flow reserve theory, PD by PN, and during adenosine infusion. Now there are many variations like IFR, instantaneous FFI, wave-free FFI, in which we do not have to give adenosine, and CTA FFR is also present. Adenosine can be given either intracoronary or intravenous infusion. So, yes. Indication is most intermediate lesions. And even in post MI situation, if other vessels are found to intermediate lesions, then we can do FFR and see whether it is doable or not. So FFR more than 0.8 is normal, we don't have to test the lesion. 0.75, 0.8 is borderline lesion. It depends on the operator. Whereas less than 0.75 is the suggested system here, we have to take the lesion. The various trials differ have 5 years of follow-up study. In this also they have shown that those FFR less than more than 0.8, if they are left on medical management, they their prognosis is as good as those who are patient in diagnosis. Now it is a class 2 recommendation of FFR in intermediate 30-70%. There are some limitations like cannot be used in condition of microvascular disease. In MI situation, if there is vulnerable plate, unstable plate, in that there is tight stenosis, not very tight. But due to the vulnerable and ruptured plate, the FFR doesn't qualify for that because the vessel is not there, the stenosis is not tight. But due to the unstable plate, we have to treat that disease. So in MI situation is not very helpful. In LVH, endothelial dysfunction, optimal result of PC also cannot be assessed as in IVUS or OCP. Also not reliable in anemia and hyperthyroidism, renal failure and in collaterals. Collaterals there was is there, basically collaterals also they supply the distal vasculation. So distal pressure is active. There is a false low pressure difference between the two. There is a false negative. IVUS also we have preserved here. IVUS is an intravascular ultrasound imaging. This is basically 40 to 45 megahertz probe. And there is a mechanical catheter system is present. So basically this is a normal result. inflammatory disease, and usually reference points from frequently narrowed and leads to underestimation of lesion stenosis. I was basically I have both pre-stenting and post-stenting growth. Pre-stenting it uses the exact the length of the disease, extent of the leg, as well as the true vessel size. And if there is a diffuse disease from osteo to distal, true vessel size will not be identified by coronary. So in this case, IOC is not helpful. So in such patients, if you can see, there is an angiography, there is not so much diagnosis. But in this, with negative remodeling, the leg is inside the lumen. So the 3.1 mm is severe. Whereas in this, the lumen grows, the leg is outside the reservoir, it's positive remodeling. The lumen lead is also small. So IOC can delineate both these type of characteristics. There is angiography. Also, there is a thin cap fibroacidoma plate, which is a thin cap. This is a thin cap. Thin cap is most vulnerable plate. So, in some situations, in MI situation, usually this thin type fibro cap is ruptured for the thin cap MI. Now, there are fixed criteria for if the, in LMCA, the luminal area is less than 6 mm square, in a proximal vessels, 4 mm square, it suggests that it is severe and we have to stand cap. Long-term clinical outcome, there are multiple trials have shown their benefit. And under expanded and malapostents, they are identified by IVUS and not by angiography. So adequate stent expansion is also helpful for IVUS. And even post-stenting also, there are criteria for less than 10% residual stenosis post-stenting is required from IVUS. Indications for IVUS are left main disease, discordant swimming symptoms and or invasive testing, some ambiguous lesions like posterior bipartition and aneurysm, hazy lesions. ISR is also very much helpful IVUS. The lesion of the characteristic of the ISR is fibrotic or calcific, we can identify. Like 360 degree calcium is also identified by IVUS. And post angiography, persistent of symptoms post PSAC also be done IVUS. This is the use of IVUS for post-stenting. This is a 3.5 stent expanded at 6 atmospheres, low atmospheres. This is not very expanded. This is a true intima reservoir. After doing 4 higher balloon at 18 atmospheres, still not much expanded. And then at very high atmospheres, only the proper stent expansion happens. So this IVUS is much helpful in using identifying stent, proper stent. So this reduces the rates of ISR. Now D7 is an extra expense, more equipment needed, more time needed for a test, limited correlation with physiology, and not always perpendicular to the vessel axis. Now, the virtual histology IOT is also the model thing. This is a deep calcium surrounded calcium. This is a superficial calcium in the advanced lesion. There is a white lesion. Present is a class 2A recommendation for moderate lesions as well as mechanism of ISR. Before PCI for distribution of coronary calcium and atherectomy, and following PCI, some optimal result and proper deployment of the stent is required. Class 3 routine angiography, when angiography diagnosis is clear and no interventional treatment is planned, is not recommended. OCT is the optimal governance tomography. The main difference is basically IVUS is a very low resolution, 150 micron, whereas OCT has very high resolution but very less penetration. Only penetration is only up to 2 mm from the vessel lumen, whereas IVUS can do up to 10 mm beyond the advent lesion. Resolution is very high, 10 to 15 micron, but IVUS is low. And for OCT, we have to insert the dye during the imaging. So it causes extra dye exposure. Whereas IVUS doesn't need any dye. OCT can also identify these various plates, thin cap, fibroacidoma. So this is the IVUS imaging, this is OCT. IVUS we can see beyond the intima, whereas in this intima and mostly some BDI is only seen in. But intima is very clearly seen, like greater luminal dissection, thrombus, leg rupture, everything is very clearly visualized in OCT. in even post stent, the 3D reconstruction of the stent, newer ASO OCT machines exist, which is very visually appealing. So this is the reverse angle OCT. So advantages of OCT, basically human ear and diameter is accurately measured, and all three layers are clearly identified. Thickness of intimine medial thickness can be measured, and different tissue reflections like calcium can also be measured. Accumulation of macrophages within fibrous gap for vulnerable that is also useful in this. And tissue characterization is better in OCT than in IPAS. So thank you, these are the intermediate results.